Hi, and a very warm welcome to you. I'm Ray Scott, and this is Visual Art Photography. Well, as the headline tells you, we're looking at five tips today that will hopefully make your photography more impactful. And you know something? I'm convinced that they will. Now, I could give you 50 tips today, but that's a lot to go through. But these five tips I've distilled from all of the tips that I've garnered over the years. I've distilled these five tips as being probably the five most important tips. Tips that will take your photography from the snapshot level to something that is very photographical, something that is highly impactful. I give you my guarantee on that. These tips are great. Not to say that there aren't a lot of others, there are, but these five tips will give you a really good foundation and will really bring your photography up. So let's get started. First off, tip number one, simplify the canvas.
All right, just a reminder that as we move through these images, often you're going to see several of these tips incorporated into an image. And that's great, you know, using different tips in the same image. All right, but the first one, simplify the canvas. Very, very simple. It's a kind of a snowy, foggy day. On the right-hand side, if this had been a clear day, then there would have been a lot of clutter there because you can get a sense that there's a lot of foliage and stuff back there. But because of the fog, it just kind of made everything almost very monochromatic, except for you can see a little bit of red in that barn. Very monochromatic, very simple. Same thing here, moving in close to this dandelion. And what you see is what you get. That's what it is, and a few of the seeds flying off. Simplify the canvas. Very, very simple here. Some grasses in front of a lake, in front of water, not the sky, water. And I mean, really, really simple, simple images. Same thing here. Bulrushes coming up in the snow. And here as well. Very, very simple. It's a way to add impact. It's almost like counterintuitive. It's like, how can it be impactful without it being complicated? But simplify the canvas is something to always keep in the back of your mind. Simplify. I had somebody ask me, why would anybody shoot an image of a bale of hay? Well, I guess maybe most people wouldn't. It's the way my mind works, you know. Simplify the canvas. Same thing here. Look at the pattern.
Another great tip. Tip number two, fill the frame.
Fill the frame. So we have a lot of clutter here as we look at this small town bakery. So I'm looking at it and I'm thinking, well, the sky is nice and blue and the building has some nice old worn paint that's blue. Maybe I can take my lens and zoom in a little bit and get something abstract like that. Fill the frame. Big difference between that and that. Fill the frame. Fill the frame. One of the reasons why macro photography is so popular is because it does fill the frame. It shows you things that you don't normally see, but filling the frame. Look at that. Fill the frame again. Move in close. Okay, an old abandoned diner. Nothing wrong with that. You're showing the structure and you're showing the growth, the weeds and everything else. Love it. Nothing wrong with that. But why not move in a little bit closer and fill the frame for something completely different and use the sky too to help you out? A completely different way of looking at this old abandoned diner by filling the frame. Now here you'd never know that I filled the frame, but I was standing on a bridge over this creek in the winter and there are trees and tangles and everything everywhere. And I zoomed in using about a 90 millimeters in order to cut out some of the noise and to hone in on what was attracting me to the whole thing, which was this tree going over the creek. And then of course that beautiful color in the ice as well. So fill the frame. Again, a field of lavender And all around it was just a lot of mess, and there were tools and equipment and things that just didn't look right. But by excluding them, what you have is the lavender and then patterns and texture and things like that. Again, filling the frame, not knowing that to the left and to the right, there were things that I really didn't want to have in there. So I was standing on a road and I put the lens at 80 millimeter and incorporated only what I wanted to see, only what I wanted the viewer to see. I used the technique filling the frame. And the last one for this, filling the frame, again, macro photography, and getting right in there, and you're seeing this butterfly.
Tip number three. Now, this is very much an optional one, but it can really, really help you, and I'll show you why. Tip number three, use a tripod.
Now, this shot you can take with or without a tripod. There's nothing very difficult about that. But this next one, same shot with the tripod, time exposure, 4 minutes. 4 minutes. I used a neutral density filter, of course, to bring that time down to up to four minutes. But without a tripod, there's no way that building would be clear. It'd be, you know, the camera would be shaking and moving and things like that. But the building is dead sharp, but the sky has moved over the course of 4 minutes, and that's the image you get. So by using a tripod, you can get images that you can't really get handheld or something like this. Now, you can do this one handheld by using a flash. I didn't. I used studio lighting, and it just made my job easier because I had total control of where I wanted the light to come from using a tripod. Again, at night, fireworks, using a tripod. Kind of essential if you want to get so many different fireworks in one image. Light trails from cars. Long exposures in the evening with a tripod. Now, you don't have to use a tripod. Maybe you could put your camera on a brick wall or a fence or something like that, but they're not always handy. A tripod, you can shoot anywhere. Or in an amusement park, a Ferris wheel. That's the way it looks during a long exposure using a tripod.
Tip number four, if you're a landscape photographer, and I know a lot of you are, shoot at the golden hour, what I like to call sweet light.
Shoot early in the day, just before and after sunrise, and just before and after sunset. And this is late in the day, winter's day, and the sun is really going down, and it's just reflecting all of this beautiful orange light on the water in this creek. And of course, the exposure was quite long, so a tripod was used. And of course, a tripod does more than just what I've been talking about. It also slows you down. That's the benefit of using a tripod. It actually slows your photography down, which makes you look in the viewfinder a little bit longer and makes you really understand what you're shooting, as opposed to just snapping shots. Again, late in the day, light clouds passing over the sun, a little bit of snow falling at the time, although you can't really see that, but a tripod. Oh, you know, they come in so handy. Same thing early in the morning before the sun has even risen at the water's edge. Big ice packs. Beautiful. Look at that. Again, that sweet light, I love to call it, the golden hour. And you use a tripod and you'd be surprised how that can change the impact of your photography. Again, just at sunset. And it's so tranquil, and it doesn't matter how long the exposure is because it's on a tripod. And everything kind of goes nice and soft to the sky, long exposure.
And tip number five, something to keep in mind on a regular basis. Foreground, middle ground, and background.
Be aware of the foreground, middle ground, and background in your landscape photography. Here, the foreground, the red fence leads you in along with some rocks to the right on the bottom. And then you have the water reflecting the huts. So you have the huts and the reflections of the hut in the water and the boats and the wharf. And then you have those hills and the rocks and everything in the background. foreground, middle ground, and background. Same thing here. Rocks and shoreline, foreground. Wharf coming out, middle. Mountains and clouds in the background. Things to be aware of. Here, not quite as distinctive. This is one of those combination things again. Oh, fill the frame, move in close, that sort of thing. Because the middle ground, which is the water, is hard to see, but there is water there, the white water, and it's rushing in. So obviously the boat is the foreground. In the middle ground, the water, but it's very narrow. It's a very narrow strip, so it's hard to really pinpoint that. And then you've got the background. That's obvious what that is. I mean, that cloud hanging over there is just boom, right? So foreground, middle ground, background, fill the frame, that sort of thing. Again, a road leading in is your foreground, middle ground, structures, background, fields, trees, sky.
And as an extra tip today, something to keep in mind when you're doing your photography, something that obviously is extremely important to you and something that you're very passionate about. Don't let anybody tell you that your photography is bad or that you should be doing something one way and you can't do it another way. If someone says that you shouldn't do something with your photography, run. Get out of there as fast as you can, because it's what you have inside of you that you want to get out. These five tips are designed to let you interpret the photography world the way you see it. And it's not going to be the way I see it or the way somebody else sees it. It's the way you see it, and that's what's important. Can you imagine back in the day when Monet was painting his impressionistic landscapes? He had so much against him. So many people were against his techniques and they're saying, no, you can't do it this way. It shouldn't be done. Can you imagine if you had listened to them? So, you know, just dial out all the noise and do what feels right to you. That might be the most important thing. And once you get through all of the basics of photography. And the other thing is, another extra tip. Yeah, I'm full of all kinds of tips today. The other one is to keep on shooting. Keep on using that camera. Now, I don't mean shoot, and then, you know, you're just arbitrarily shooting everything and making the same mistakes over and over again and getting really good at being bad. I don't mean that. But use your camera a lot, all right? I mean, if it sits in the closet, it's not going to do you much good. So make sure you use all of that beautiful equipment that you have. And have a ton of fun. And remember, there's no real bad or good. I mean, yes, you can practice being not so good and you can do all kinds of, but there's no real bad or good. It's just trying to get more impact into your shots, more wow shots, that kind of thing, and just have a ton of fun with it. That's the biggest tip probably. Until next time, I'm Ray Scott reminding you, it's not what you see, it's how you see it. And I'll see you soon.